Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Indigenous Continent, the Epic Contest for North America. By Pekka Hamalainen. Read by Kaipo Schwab. Introduction. The Myth of Colonial America. There is an old, deeply rooted story about America that goes something like this. Columbus stumbles upon a strange continent and brings back stories of untold riches. The European empires rush over, eager to stake out as much of this astonishing new world as possible. Even as they clash, they ignite an era of colonial expansion that lasts roughly four centuries, from the conquest of Hispaniola in 1492 to the Wounded Knee Massacre in 1890. Between those two moments, European empires and the nascent American empire amass souls, slaves, and territory, dispossessing and destroying hundreds of indigenous societies. The Indians fight back but cannot stop the onslaught. Resourceful and defiant though they might be, they are no match for the newcomers, and their raw ambition, superior technology, and lethal microbes that penetrate native bodies with shocking ease. Indians are doomed. Europeans are destined to take over the continent. History itself is a linear process that moves irreversibly toward indigenous destruction. Indigenous Continent tells a different story. It offers a new account of American history by challenging the notion that colonial expansion was inevitable, and that colonialism defined the continent, as well as the experiences of those living on it. Stepping outside of such outdated assumptions, this book reveals a world that remained overwhelmingly indigenous well into the 19th century. It argues that rather than a colonial America, we should speak of an indigenous America that was only slowly and unevenly becoming colonial. By 1776, various European colonial powers together claimed nearly all of the continent for themselves, but indigenous peoples and powers controlled it. The maps and modern textbooks that paint much of early North America with neat, color-coded blocks confuse outlandish imperial claims for actual holdings. The history of the overwhelming and persisting indigenous power recounted here remains largely unknown, and it is the biggest blind spot in common understandings of the American past. The reality of an indigenous continent has remained obscure because European empires, and especially the United States, invested power in the state and its bureaucracy, whereas native nations invested power in kinship. From the beginning, European arrivals judged Indians on European terms. Later historians did the same, focusing on state power as the driving force in America. Kinship could be a source of great power, and indigenous nations possessed advanced political systems that allowed for flexible diplomacy and war-making, even if Euro-Americans often failed to see them. Time and again, and across centuries, Indians blocked and destroyed colonial projects, forcing Euro-Americans to accept native ways, native sovereignty, and native dominance. This is what the historical record shows when American history is detached from mainstream historical narratives that privilege European ambitions, European perspectives, and European sources. The traditional master narrative is entrenched in our culture and minds. Consider how Red Cloud's War and Custer's Last Stand are usually understood. According to the conventional narrative, in a single decade between 1866 and 1876, the Lakota Indians and their Cheyenne and Arapaho allies defeated the United States in two wars, first along the Bozeman Trail in what became known as Red Cloud's War, and then in the Battle of the Little Bighorn, where they annihilated George Armstrong Custer's 7th U.S. Cavalry Regiment. Both defeats have entered American history as aberrations or flukes. The United States, after all, had already become a continent-spanning military-industrial power poised to expand beyond the West Coast. the Lakotas had humiliated the United States at a charged moment when the nation was shedding its frontier identity and entering the modern era of the corporate, the bureaucratic, and the scientific. The fiascos would be blamed on poor generalship and on a canny enemy familiar with the terrain. Seen from Native American perspective, however, Red Cloud's War and Custer's Last Stand appear not as historical anomalies, but as the logical culmination of a long history of indigenous power in North America. They were more expected than extraordinary. From the beginning of colonialism in North America to the Lakota's final military triumphs, a multitude of Native nations fought fiercely to keep their territories intact and their cultures untainted, frustrating the imperial pretensions of France, Spain, Britain, the Netherlands, and eventually the United States. This indigenous infinity of nations included Iroquois, Catawbas, Odawas, Osages, Wyandots, Cherokees, Comanches, Cheyennes, Apaches, and many others. Although each nation was and is distinct, a cultural crevasse separated the European newcomers from all indigenous inhabitants of the continent, generating fear, confusion, anger, and violence. That divide fueled one of the longest conflicts in history, while simultaneously inspiring a centuries-long search for mutual understanding and accommodation, a search that continues today. The great pitfalls in the study of Native Americans are broad generalizations on the one hand and narrow specificity on the other. For a long time, historians tended to see Indians as a human monolith cut from a single and primordial cultural cloth, a race defined by its tragic history of dispossession and its epic struggle for survival. This tradition informs many popular books that repackage Native American history into a morality play that is often more concerned with the United States and its character than with the Indians themselves. In these depictions of Native America, Indians appear as one-dimensional stock figures, their complexity and differences pressed flat for dramatic purposes. They are reduced to mere props in the United States' violent transformation into a global power. Indigenous resistance and suffering heighten the drama, enabling people today to glimpse how much was lost and at what cost. On the other end of the spectrum is a venerable tradition of tribal histories, each focusing on a single Native nation and providing a comprehensive portrait of its traditions, political structures, material culture, and historical experiences. This necessary and often superb scholarship has brought to life hundreds of previously obscured indigenous peoples as forceful, creative, and resilient historical actors, filling a half-illuminated continent with human texture. The downside of this approach is its particularity. Each nation comes across as unique, embedded in its own micro-world. Multiply this by 500, and the problem is plain to see. Examining indigenous America in this way is like looking at a pointillistic painting from mere inches away. It overwhelms. It loses coherence. The larger patterns are impossible to discern. With the perspective adjusted just slightly, however, a new and sharper image of North America comes into view. Indigenous Continent takes a middle course between the general and the specific, uncovering a broad range of Native American worlds that rose and fell across the continent from the early 16th century into the late 19th century. In numerous realms, Indians and colonists competed for territory, resources, power, and supremacy, with survival often hanging in the balance. Each realm had its own character, reflecting the continent's astounding physical diversity. The stakes and dynamics of warfare, diplomacy, and belonging played out differently along coasts, along river valleys, in woodlands, in grasslands, and in the mountains. This book is first and foremost a history of indigenous peoples, but it is also a history of colonialism. The history of North America that emerges is of a place and an era shaped by warfare above all. The contest for the continent was, in essence, a four centuries long war, that saw almost every Native nation fight encroaching colonial powers, sometimes in alliances, sometimes alone. Although the Indian Wars in North America have been written about many times before, this book offers a broad indigenous view of the conflict. For Native nations, war was often a last resort. In many cases, if not most, they attempted to bring Europeans into their fold, making them useful. These were not the actions of supplicants. The Europeans were the supplicants, their lives, movements, and ambitions determined by Native nations that drew the newcomers into their settlements and kinship networks, seeking trade and allies. Indian men and women alike were sophisticated diplomats, shrewd traders, and forceful leaders. The haughty Europeans assumed that the Indians were weak and uncivilized, only to find themselves forced to agree to humiliating terms, in inversion of common assumptions about white dominance and Indian dispossession that have survived to the present. When war did come, Indians won as often as not. Older, discredited, and ludicrous notions of savage Indians or noble savages suggest a certain degree of brutality in battle. But it was the colonists who were responsible for most atrocities. Many colonists, especially the British, Spanish, and Americans, were guilty of ethnic cleansing, genocide, and other crimes. But some adopted more measured approaches to native peoples. There were colonists who utterly despised Indians and wanted to eradicate them. But there were also colonial regimes that sought to embrace them. There were many types of colonialism: settler, imperial, missionary, extractive, commercial, and legal. And they emerge cumulatively as the story told here progresses. Tracing the evolution of colonialism is vital. The depth and reach of indigenous power can be truly understood only against the massive colonial challenge from Europe. I have tried to show the full potential of colonialism to destroy lives, nations, and civilizations. It is against that horrific violence that indigenous power is revealed. Overseas, colonialism was a daunting endeavor that required courage and commitment. European intruders were ruthless because they held deep-seated racist ideologies and because the stakes were so high. For most of them, there was no going back. A single-volume continental history of North America cannot devote equal attention to all native nations, regions, and events. Large indigenous nations and confederacies were able to confront European empires on their own terms, and they drive much of the story through their sheer capacity to keep North America indigenous. But the smaller nations and their resistance were also essential to the making of the indigenous continent. Preserving indigenous power and sovereignty was a total endeavor. Every colonial intrusion, however small, could generate a domino effect of native retreats. Accordingly, this book zooms in frequently to local and intimate scales. It was there, in face-to-face encounters, where the hard work of colonizing and resisting colonization happened. Indigenous Americans were fighting for their land, for their lives, and for future generations. Every inch mattered. This book covers a vast span of history, 4 centuries and a continent. But it is given shape, direction, and meaning by a single theme: power. Here, power is defined as the ability of people and their communities to control space and resources, to influence the actions and perceptions of others, to hold enemies at bay, to muster otherworldly beings, and to initiate and resist change. What follows is the story of a long and turbulent epoch, when North America was contested by many and dominated by none. This story traces how people gained, lost, and in rare instances, shared power with strangers, creating many new worlds in the process. The book might be best described as a biography of power in North America. The story follows critical action and key turning points across the contested continent, showing how various parts of it became geopolitical hotspots, where rivalries intensified and where history turned violently. Although the book is inclusive, focusing on both European colonists and Native Americans, the usual actors, events, and turning points of American history retreat to the background. The Stamp and T-Ax, Boston Massacre, and creation of the U.S. Constitution figure only marginally in this history. Indians controlled most of North America, and often they did not know about the exploits of the Europeans beyond their borders. And if they did, they did not care. Instead, the indigenous peoples were interested in the ambitions and experiences of other indigenous peoples, the Iroquois, Cherokees, Lakotas, Comanches, Shawnees, and many others. A note on terminology and style. I have occasionally modernized direct quotes when spelling makes them hard to understand. Taking a cue from Nancy Shoemaker, I call Native men and women involved in war soldiers, not warriors. The settlements of more sedentary Native nations are towns, whereas the more mobile, nomadic settlements are villages. Rather than chiefs, I use either indigenous terms for leaders or simply officials or officers, because they were indigenous administrators. As for the names of Indian nations, I have used what they themselves prefer: Odawas rather than Ottawas, Lenapes rather than Delawares, Wyandots rather than Hurons, Illini rather than Illinois, Meskwakis rather than Foxes, Ho-Chunks rather than Winnebagoes, Muscogees rather than Creeks, Ojibwes rather than Ojibwas. The Iroquois are also called Haudenosaunee. Part 1. The Dawn of the Indigenous Continent. The First 70 Millennia. Chapter 1. The World on the Turtle's Back. Kelp was the key to America. During the last ice age, starting 2.5 million years ago, vast ice sheets locked up so much of the world's water that the sea level dropped drastically, changing the surface of the earth. Islands became isthmuses, and seafloors became meadows. The most consequential exposure in North America took place in the Bering Strait, where, about 70,000 years ago, a 600-mile-wide landmass emerged to connect Asia and America. That swath of new land, Beringia, was scored by rivers, speckled with small lakes, and covered with grasses and shrubs that supported thriving animal communities, drawing people into America from the West. The melting of glaciers started in North America roughly 21,000 years ago. As the mile-high ice caps slowly melted into the oceans, a narrow, ice-free corridor opened on the eastern flank of the Rocky Mountains. Groups of people began moving southward through the passage around 11,000 BCE, eventually arriving in the great continental grasslands that were swarming with huge mammals: imperial mammoths, 6-ton mastodons, 8-foot-tall bison, giant ground sloths, short-faced bears, camels, horses, and several species of antelope. The size and number of the beasts required technological innovation by the people now in the region, and groups of hunters began using flint, chert, obsidian, and other malleable stone to craft sharp-edged, fluted spear points that could penetrate a beast's thick skin with lethal efficiency. Hunters would travel hundreds of miles to prime quarry sites to obtain the best stone. Lower-risk subsistence strategies, foraging, fishing and hunting small game, rounded out diets, supporting growing and resilient human communities. Yet the Western Hemisphere was still only patchily inhabited by people. Other migration waves proceeded through an older and quite possibly busier maritime route that traced the Pacific Rim, where people moved in skin boats along the shore, subsisting on the rich marine and estuarine life that flourished in a cool water offshore zone, a kelp highway that spanned from northeastern Asia to the Andean coast. Nutrient-rich kelp beds supported colonies of fish, shellfish, seabirds, seaweed, and sea otters, enabling people to enjoy rich and balanced diets. For these amphibian people, the quest for food was safer and most likely more efficient than that of the big game hunters in the interior. They could find a wealth of seafood in the mangrove forests near shore, shifting from one bounteous habitat to another, splintering when necessary. Highly mobile maritime hunter-gatherers may have reached Monteverde in modern-day southern Chile, 10,000 miles south of the Bering Strait, as early as 16,500 BCE. The earliest traces of people in North America have been found in the southwest, where human presence dates back 23,000 years. People who had spread across an entire hemisphere remarkably fast did so against daunting odds. Unlike its eastern counterpart, the western hemisphere has a pronounced north-south orientation, and people on the move had to negotiate numerous climatic and ecological circumstances, adapting their food search, tools, clothing, dwellings, social systems, and mindsets to challenging conditions. Many Native American origin stories speak of rising tides and mountains of water that seem to describe melting glaciers releasing themselves over the land. It was already clear at this early point that the Americas would be defined by astounding human diversity and resilience. There had been another world before this one, an island world floating in the sky, happily inhabited by sky people. But when Sky Woman became inexplicably pregnant, her husband was furious. He ripped up a great tree, creating a hole in the sky, and pushed Sky Woman through it toward a watery world far below. Ducks caught Sky Woman with their wings and laid her on the back of the turtle, who allowed her to rest there. The turtle declared that her arrival was a good omen. Sky Woman was no longer an outsider. The water animals, the beaver, the loon, and many others, dived deep, trying to bring back mud from the bottom of the sea for Sky Woman to walk on, but they all failed. Only the muskrat succeeded, delivering a handful of mud. The animals spread it on the turtle's back and saw that the mud had the power to expand. It became an island, then an enormous expanse of dry land. That was the birthplace and home of the Iroquois people. Sky Woman had a daughter, who in turn had two sons, Tharin Hiawagon, who was good, and Tawiskaron, who was evil. Tawiskaron entered the world by tearing a hole in his mother's side, killing her. But Tharin Hiawagon made the sun, lakes, rivers, and mountains from her body. Consumed by envy, Tawiskaron tried to undo his brother's creation, and Tharin Hiawagon killed him. This was not a sign of dysfunction, but of balance. The world was neither entirely evil nor entirely good. Sky Woman kept it in balance. The Pawnee people, too, received guidance from above, but they emerged from beneath. In the beginning, Tirawa, father, was at the center of things below, but the world had no shape, no order, only chaos. Tirawa summoned the powers of the skies. He sent out his thoughts and created celestial gods to bring order, the evening star to the west to represent Pawnee men, and the morning star to the east to represent Pawnee women. The morning star gave birth to the first being on earth, and through her, four helpers, wind, cloud, lightning, and thunder, guided the Pawnees into the plains where they discovered corn and buffalo, the foundation of their material and spiritual existence. Rather than cataclysmic change and movement, the Pawnee origin story revolves around a search for social and cosmic order in a very particular place. For Pawnees, the Platte, Republican, and Loup rivers in the Great Plains were, and are, the center of the world. An origin story of the Cherokees, who call themselves Aniunwia, meaning real people, tells of the slow creation of the world. In the beginning, the earth was a floating island in a sea, suspended by cords attached to Galunlati, a sky world of solid rock. The earth was soft and wet, and the animals sent out the great buzzard to prepare the world below for them. But he struggled to find dry land. He grew tired, and his wings began to hit the ground, creating a series of valleys and mountains. That mountainous country became Cherokee land. The great buzzard created animals and plants first, humans later. At first, there were only a brother and sister. He struck the sister with a fish and told her to multiply. At the start, she gave birth every seventh day, and the world was in danger of becoming overcrowded. So she began having one child every year, thus stabilizing the world. Like the Cherokees, the Sichangu Lakotas have an origin story that centers on reciprocal relationships between humans and animals and between humans and the earth. There had been an earlier world, but people did not know how to live in it properly, and Thunkasila, grandfather, decided to create a new one. He cracked the earth open, and water flowed out, covering everything. All the people and animals died, except for the crow. The crow begged Thunkasila for a place to rest. Thunkasila covered the world with land and shed tears that became seas, lakes, and rivers. He opened his pipe bag, took out animals and plants, and allowed them to spread over the land. Only then did he form human beings from earth. He promised not to drown the new world if people treated his creation with respect. "Now," he said, "if you have learned how to behave like human beings and how to live in peace with each other and with the other living things, the two-legged, the four-legged, the man-legged, the flyers, the no-legs, the green plants of this universe, then all will be well. But if you make this world bad and ugly, then I will destroy this world too. It's up to you." While many origin stories of indigenous nations in North America explain the creation of the universe along with the creation of a specific people, the Kiowas have a story that explains their distinctive attribute, their small numbers. The Kiowa people, Kaigwu, principal people, came to this world through a hollow log, one by one. But then a woman, her body bulky with child, got stuck. Many people were still waiting to emerge from the log, but there was no way out, so the Kiowas never numbered more than 3,000 people. The Navajos emerged from a lower world, but they were still evolving when they did. The first man and the first woman were the Mist people, who lacked discipline and undermined hojo, harmony. They moved through several worlds, accruing knowledge and reason in each, and finally arrived in the present world, fully formed and with a gender balance in opportunities and challenges. The first man and the first woman now knew how to treat each other, other peoples, and all the living creatures properly. Dineta, the Navajo homeland, could come into being amid four sacred mountains. The first man and the first woman found a baby and raised her. She became Changing Woman, who married the sun, and together they went to the Western Ocean, raised four clans, and took them back to Dineta, making their world complete. These and many other origin stories explain how a new multi-ethnic world, Indigenous America, took shape. The origin stories are not necessarily in conflict with some scientific theories about the peopling of the Americas. References to lands exposed during the Ice Age and to the re-emergence of dry land when glaciers began to melt are not hard to detect in indigenous origin stories. The ubiquitous floods, sudden, devastating, regenerative, in origin stories tell of the radical changes that humans faced in North America starting about 17,000 BCE. These stories illuminate an indigenous America that is old, complex, and dynamic. The Pacific coast of Meso and North America features 143 different native languages, most likely the result of recurring splintering over 35,000 years from a single original tongue. The first Americans did not divide the world into hemispheres and continents. They had not crossed seas or oceans to reach America, and they did not think they had arrived in some kind of new world. They had faced severe ecological upheavals during their travels, and they had prevailed, often by dividing tasks according to gender. Understanding the world and its unpredictability, its dangers and its gifts, was all important. Forming proper relationships to the land and its life forms was everything. These people did not think they were occupying new lands because they had been there always. By 10,000 BCE, there were people in nearly every part of the Western Hemisphere, from still glacial Alaska and the Yukon to Monte Verde in South America. North America had become an indigenous continent. It would remain so for nearly 12 millennia. In 10,000 BCE, the people in the Americas were hunter-gatherers, and they were thriving. Their world was filled with megafauna, and they were pioneering new hunting methods, operating in small groups with a range of duties, and performing the necessary rituals to establish a proper relationship between hunter and prey, tracking the animals and leading them to a kill site, often near a waterhole, felling the gigantic beasts with coordinated spear thrusts, processing the meat, bones, and hides for immediate and future use. The profusion of game persisted for 2 millennia, but then the continental ice sheets began melting rapidly, and the giant mammals began dying out, debilitated by a warming and increasingly erratic climate. Apparently unaware of how fragile the animal populations had become, humans kept hunting the great beasts, perhaps expanding the use of fire and thereby delivering an unintended final blow. By 8,000 BCE, some 36 species of giant animals had become extinct. It was at this point that many first Americans in the North American West shifted to bison hunting. Relatively recent Beringian migrants themselves, bison were aggressive, prolific, and highly adaptive animals that avoided extinction by specializing in short grass grazing. They literally shrank over millennia to survive the shifting conditions in the arid West, becoming lighter, faster, and more mobile. Hunters, too, had to adapt. A refined, grooved, and extremely thin and therefore powerful spear point announced the rise of a new hunting civilization, whose people operated in highly mobile bands that could follow the herds for hundreds of miles, trap dozens of beasts for a kill, or drive entire herds into a box canyon, down a ravine, or off cliffs. As the climate warmed, sustaining the growth of grass and other forage, animal populations proliferated, pushing the hunters to continue innovating. The invention of the atlatl, around 7500 BCE, was a breakthrough. A wooden stick with a shaft on one end and a socket on the other, the atlatl enabled the thrower to propel a light spear faster and farther, with a flipping motion that channeled stored energy in a spring-like effect. Essentially an extension of the hunter's arm, the atlatl transformed hunting into a relatively safe and easy affair. Pedestrian hunters could now kill their prey from a distance of up to 150 yards. Maritime foragers found the atlatl highly useful because it left one hand free for steering the vessel. Fluted spear points fell out of use. Though they slaughtered animals by the thousands, the first Americans treated their quarry with respect and care. To become effective hunters, they had to understand animal behavior intimately and know how to manipulate animal habitats, especially with strategic fires, to ensure predictable herd movements and successful hunts. They needed to approach the animals with correct thoughts and ceremonies to secure their sacrifice, and they had to accept the animals' gifts, skin, flesh, bone, blood, with reverence and compassion. Failing to do so would have alienated animal spirits and shattered the ancient bonds of kinship with human beings. It was this mindset of respect and care that sustained North America as a hunter's world for several millennia. People faced the need to explore other ways of life only from about 4500 BCE on. Acorns. The nuts of oak trees are rich in iron, calcium, potassium, fiber, carbohydrates, monounsaturated fats, and vitamins A, B, and E. They also stabilize the human metabolism and blood sugar levels. The first Americans who made North America's West Coast their home relied heavily on acorns and kelp, founding an entire civilization on them. They fashioned refined stone mortars and grinders to leach the tannic acid out of the precious nuts, and they designed light and capacious baskets to carry and store the nuts. Nomadic peoples built settlements near acorn groves, anchoring themselves to the land, and before long they were practicing small-scale agriculture under local leaders who coordinated fire fallow cultivation and the allocation of land and crops. So abundant was the acorn yield that West Coast peoples were only marginally interested in corn cultivation. This Pacific-bound indigenous world shunned political centralization. Communities consisted of several close-knit kinship groups that enjoyed exclusive rights to wild food patches, hunting ranges, and fisheries. Foodstuffs, tools, medicinal plants, and luxuries circulated through local and long-distance trade networks, creating a vast regional web of reciprocity and sharing. And ocean currents brought resources, flotsam, redwood logs, bamboo, virtually to their homes. What would become known as California was an affluent, politically sophisticated, and safe world, a maritime civilization tethered to an unusually fertile kelp-rich shore and boosted by acorns. It may have been the most densely populated region of North America. The trajectory of the indigenous West Coast, though distinctive, points to a broader dynamic. All across the Americas, people were recalibrating what was possible. The Western Hemisphere was diversifying into numerous unique worlds. Along the Northwest Coast, the warm Kuroshio and North Pacific currents spawned a moderate climate and heavy rainfall. Salmon became the mainstay and the center of the locals' unique culture. They believed salmon were eternal beings who lived in subsurface houses during winter. If summoned with proper prayers, the salmon assumed their form as fish in the spring and filled the rivers, giving themselves up. Seafaring hunters ventured in dugout canoes to track whales, seals, sea otters, and other marine megafauna that flourished in the kelp forests, extending their world, their economies, social networks, and spiritual lives deep into the Pacific. Such a dramatic extension of reach and ambition required adaptability, compromise, and creativity. Relatively classless local communities gave way to more hierarchical orders that could mobilize labor on a large scale and enforce social specialization. By the early second millennium CE, around the 1300s, the Northwest Coast was dotted with sumptuous cedar plank houses that could be 500 feet long and 75 feet wide and accommodate multiple families. These houses were adorned with false front facades, decorated with stylized animal imagery that represented specific clans, and in front of them stood finely carved totem poles, reaching toward the skies. The Northwest Coast people became ranked societies that distinguished individuals by their genealogical distance from elite families. The great houses were the Northwest Coast civilization in microcosm, symbolizing and safeguarding it. Just as the households were founded on a system of social ranking, so too were the many nations, the Tlingits, Haidas, Kwakutals, Bellakulas, Makas, Chinooks, and others, that shared the region. The households that together constituted a nation competed openly for prestige and power in sumptuous potlatch ceremonies, where wealthy families publicly shared their possessions with poorer ones, reaffirming their preeminence. What worked on the small scale also worked on the large scale. The Northwest Coast people had turned ambition, abundance, and rivalry into a cohesive social force. Much of the land was held in commons as shared resource rather than private property. By 1500 BCE, the indigenous worlds in North America were flourishing, built on kelp, acorns, hunting, and fishing, and laying the foundation for later civilizations. Chapter 2. The Egalitarian Continent. Corn is one of humankind's greatest feats of genetic engineering. It does not exist in the wild. Its kernels are too tightly attached to the cobs to allow self-seeding, so it needs to be sown and tended to survive. It is a cultural artifact, created and perfected by humans through systematic and bold biological manipulation. Its parent plant was teosinte, a weedy, inedible mountain grass native to the Mesoamerican highland valleys. But corn looks almost nothing like teosinte. Teosinte had several thin stalks, a small cob, and a hard casing, whereas corn has a single heavy stalk capable of supporting several heavy ears. Highland peoples domesticated corn between 9 and 6,000 years ago. They kept refining the plant, inspecting the seeds, and breeding numerous local varieties that varied in taste, texture, and color, and that thrived in different climates, soils, and elevations. The size of cobs could range from a few inches to 20, and they could be covered in multiple rows of kernels. With skilled human help, this highly adaptive species was poised to take over the world. The Tehuacan Valley was an early center of the systematic cultivation of corn, and agriculture-based village life took root there by 1500 BCE. Political centralization followed, giving rise to empires that drew people into their orbit through military might, appealing religious ceremonies, and long-distance trade. Interlocking webs of local trade networks carried corn seeds south and north from Mesoamerica. Corn cultivation began in the southwestern Amazon rainforest around 4500 BCE, and the crop reached the semi-arid highlands of the North American Southwest around 2000 BCE. A true dietary revolution came later, with the arrival of maíz de ocho in the first millennium of our era. A major step in the long evolution of corn, the maíz de ocho variety was robust, adaptable, and easy to process. It flowered quickly, requiring less labor, and could withstand harsh weather. When farmers began growing beans and squash along with maíz de ocho some 1,500 years ago, they created an ecologically compatible triad of crops. The three sisters that revolutionized food production and diets in North America. By planting the three crops together, indigenous farmers created a set of highly beneficial synergies. Corn's tall and sturdy stalks provided a strong structure on which bean vines could climb. Corn's high nutrient requirements could quickly deplete the soil of nitrogen, a vital ingredient in photosynthesis, the process by which light energy is converted into chemical energy that plants can use. Here, farmers could rely on beans to help. Nodules on their roots have microbes that pull nitrogen from the air, convert it to a form that corn and squash can use, and return it to the soil as a natural fertilizer. As beans climb up the corn stalks toward the sun, squash provides essential protections, spreading near the ground. It offers shade with its broad leaves, helping the soil to retain moisture and deterring weeds, and its prickly hairs repel rodents and other pests. The outcome of this companion planting was a nearly ideal human diet. Corn is rich in carbohydrates, whereas beans, especially when dried, yield plenty of protein. And together, the three crops provide most essential vitamins and minerals. As in earlier eras in Mesoamerica, abundance encouraged ambition and innovation. Towns and cities rose across the vast region, bringing large numbers of people together and incubating new ideas and technologies. Shamans, indigenous physicians, and ritualists traveled along roads and waterways, seeking and sharing knowledge and rites that helped them to balance the universe. During the second half of the first millennium, the Hohokam and Mogollon peoples turned away from casual farming and embraced large-scale canal irrigation and terrace agriculture in their high-altitude desert homelands along and west of the upper Rio Grande Valley, relying on underground water reservoirs irrigation ducts, and floodwater diversions. They developed bigger strains of corn through hybridization, and soon they could feed several thousand. Men were largely responsible for the intensive agricultural work, although, in line with an ancient tradition, the land and the crops belonged to women, whose kinship networks sustained public order. They constructed multi-story adobe clay buildings with grand courtyards. Grandmothers were the social and moral center of these emerging agricultural communities, and women began to produce crafts and crops for external markets, as the origin stories had anticipated. Around 900 CE, rising global temperatures ushered in a new climate cycle, the warm period, which lengthened growing seasons. Hohokam and Mogollon farmers benefited greatly from the new climate regime, but it was the ancestral Puebloans who made the most of it. By the middle of the 11th century, around 1050 CE, the 10-mile-long Chaco Canyon in the Colorado Plateau had become a dominant urban center that nearly monopolized the highly lucrative trade in turquoise stones, a luxury item. There, over three centuries, the ancestral Puebloans built a monumental communal stone building, later known as Pueblo Bonito, that served as the political, commercial, and religious center of the Chacoan world. It is possible that Pueblo Bonito was built by slave labor. Five stories high, the finely engineered, D-shaped, sandstone structure boasted hundreds of rooms, several stairways, and two large, enclosed courtyard plazas with over 30 kivas, underground ceremonial chambers. With high walls on its north, east, and south sides, it sat in the middle of dozens of great houses and countless modest ones. Yet perhaps only 20 families lived there. Pueblo Bonito may have been an elite-run redistribution center that absorbed goods from the outlying commoners who made regular pilgrimages to the great houses. 400 miles of arrow-straight roads linked the magnet-like center to some 75 communities, and Pueblo Bonito featured massive storage rooms for corn, beans, squash, and other imported necessities. Long-distance trade networks brought luxuries from Mesoamerica, and an enigmatic 40-mile-long Great North Road may have been built to symbolize Pueblo Bonito's material and spiritual primacy. The settlement was divided into two balanced halves, perhaps to reflect the duality between the sacred and the secular, or a deepening division between elites and commoners. Kachinas, spirit beings, moved between the underworld and the earth, embodying the duality of the Pueblo world as established in origin stories. Thousands of years ago, sometime after 1700 BCE, people started moving earth to a narrow and slightly elevated landform near the lower Mississippi Valley. They persisted in the task from one generation to the next, transporting millions of cubic feet of dirt until, four centuries later, they had what they wanted: a 75-foot-high bird-shaped earthwork, six concentric C-shaped earthen ridges that may have served as dwelling sites, and a large central plaza facing the river, all of it protected against the dramatic annual floods by levees. It was at once a settlement, a ceremonial center, and a commercial hub that welcomed in, and most likely redistributed, large quantities of copper, jasper, quartz, pipestone, shark teeth, and marine shells from all directions. The town's original citizens were egalitarian hunter-fisher-gatherers, who seemed to have established a hierarchical political system in order to mobilize labor on a larger scale. The architects of this economic regime were pioneers, and their experiment lasted for six centuries until about 700 BCE. Others picked up where they left off: a new mound-builder civilization, Adena Hopewell, emerged in the central Ohio Valley, where people came together to build colossal ceremonial mounds of different shapes, circles, octagons, squares, that publicized the centrality, power, and humility of its inhabitants. They imported obsidian and bear teeth from the Rocky Mountains, mica and quartz from the Appalachians, copper and pipestone from the Great Lakes, and tortoise shells and shark teeth from the Caribbean. And they themselves were artisans who made stunning copper effigies and masks portraying birds, fish, beavers, bears, and human faces. Theirs was a society that depended on connections among peoples. Those linkages disintegrated rapidly when corn and beans became staples in the 5th century. The life-giving plants made kinship networks self-sufficient. Populations expanded, people moved into walled towns, and face-to-face connections gave way to more formal relations. Towns began to compete for farmlands and political preeminence, and the ancient collective ethos crumbled. By the early 6th century CE, the great Adena Hopewell civilization had dissolved into countless competing groups. The indigenous history of North America in the late 1st and early 2nd millennia CE was characterized by a distinctive pattern of simultaneous centralization and decentralization. Regional centers hoarded power, fueling resentment among subordinate groups that eventually revolted or splintered off, sometimes founding new regimes. The pattern was evident in the sequence from Mogollon to Hohokam to ancestral Puebloan in the southwest, and it was particularly pronounced in the shift from Poverty Point to Adena Hopewellian culture in the Mississippi Valley. Perhaps the most dramatic version of the sequence unfolded in the American Bottom, a 60-mile-wide floodplain at the junction of the Missouri and Mississippi rivers, during the 11th century, at the height of the warm period. At an ancient river crossing and transportation hub stood a modest village of hunters and gatherers. But around 1000 CE, newcomers settled in the area. Growers of corn, they razed the existing buildings so that they could build a city. The newcomers turned the marshy floodplain, packed with highly fertile alluvium, into fields and started building their new capital city. Their highly driven elites mobilized commoners and slaves to drain marshes, clear rectangular public plazas, and move enormous amounts of soil so that they could build huge earthen mounds and broad causeways to connect them to one another. The great city was laid in a grid pattern, and the newcomers' ultimate achievement would be a colossal central mound, a stately pyramidal structure that rose in 4 terraces to 100 feet above ground. It covered 16 acres at its base. Centuries later, Europeans named it Monk's Mound. Cahokia, as this new city became known, was built to impress and to embed its inhabitants properly in the cosmos. Its geography was sacred geography. Monk's Mound was aligned with the cardinal directions, and the principal mounds in the center of the city were aligned with Monk's Mound and each other. Monk's Mound towered over the Grand Plaza, an enormous artificial plain that was created by swales being filled with soil, establishing a literal vertical distance between elites and commoners. Atop Monk's Mound, chiefs and priests connected the worlds above and below and presided over their people, expecting them to show the humility and loyalty that kept their world safe. The city's leaders, and perhaps also the commoners, consumed the caffeine-laced black drink to ritually purify themselves. Cahokia was also an economic experiment. The city's elites, the chiefs and priests, desired luxuries for their own aesthetic pleasure and as status symbols. The city was encircled by satellite townships, whose chiefs owed loyalty to Cahokia's paramount chief and made their allegiances tangible through gifts. At the same time, Cahokia was a thriving center of trade. From the city's position near the confluence of the Mississippi, Missouri, and Illinois rivers, its commercial hinterland extended from the Great Lakes to the Gulf Coast and the Appalachians, importing such necessities as salt and sandstone, and such luxuries as copperware, Mill Creek chert, and finely crafted stone knives. Cahokia may have begun as a collective effort of people who understood themselves as a single kin community. But over time, it transformed into an elite-run state. The triggering factor was the colossal building projects that absorbed inordinate amounts of labor. Monk's Mound alone consisted of 22 million cubic feet of soil, all of it transported in baskets, carried by humans, to the construction site. Completing that gargantuan project may have taken 370,000 days of labor in total, and although it was the largest, it was but one of some 200 mounds that would eventually dot the cityscape. At some point, to get the job done required coercion, giving rise to a ranked society. An aristocracy began to command lesser people and their labor, possibly through violence. Cahokia had become a theater of power. Whether its elites appealed to spiritual mandates or relied on sheer force, thousands of common people now spent much of their time on the ritual work of transforming the earth into a new shape and on raising food for the nobility. They depended on the generosity of their leaders to access some of the wealth that had suffused the booming metropolis. One elite festival featured nearly 4,000 deer, 18,000 earthen pots, and a generous offer of potent tobacco. Marine shell beads, calumella pendants, and rattles, as well as figurines of raptors, snakes, and female deities carved of quartz crystals, mica, and galena, flowed from Cahokia into the adjacent rural settlements, publicizing elite power and generosity. The power of the elite was only superficially political. Its true sources and manifestations were sacred. Chiefs and priests knew, or claimed to know, how to communicate with other than human beings and to control the sun, the earth, seasons, rains, crops, and game. The paramount chief needed the city's prodigious wealth in corn and luxuries to flow to him so that he could pass them on to the needy, create bonds of obligation, appease other than human creators, forge alliances with outsiders, and proclaim his own prominence. Power in Cahokia became highly personalized, embodied by the paramount chief and his lineage. Cahokians, or a critical number of them, came to believe that a chief's power should extend into the afterlife. In the early 11th century, approximately 270 people were ritually sacrificed and buried in a series of mass graves to accompany elite persons in death. In another instance, 118 female captives were brought to Cahokia and killed. One mass grave was covered with more than 20,000 marine shell beads arranged in the shape of a bird. Cahokia's theocratic leaders established alliances with the elites of the surrounding mound builder villages, creating a fluid network of allegiances that resembled the ambitions of Europe's medieval barons and other nobility who strove to control scattered castles and contested territories. Games of chunki drew people together into huge arenas to watch contestants tossing a disc-shaped stone on the ground and sending spears toward it as it rolled, trying to land them as close to its stopping point as possible. When Cahokian ambassadors visited the outlying villages, they carried with them both war clubs and chunki stones, possibly to emphasize both the competitive and the cooperative nature of their relationships. The force of their diplomacy seems to have established a long era of peace and stability. A Pax Cahokia, in the heart of the continent. At its peak, Cahokia may have had 15,000 residents and 30,000 people in its orbit, sustaining the great city. Cahokia was the zenith of, and perhaps the model for, a widespread Mississippian culture that encompassed much of the eastern woodlands for more than eight centuries in an ever-shifting constellation of regional variations. Large population centers expanded their food production to near carrying capacity under an unusual weather regime in which long summers and long growing seasons coincided with a long wet cycle. But then, in the early 14th century, the climate shifted again, ending the warm period. A global cooling period, the Little Ice Age, brought unpredictable rainfall, droughts, and cold spells, forcing people to recalibrate their expectations. The Little Ice Age ushered in a world where almost everything had to be smaller. Harvests, markets, settlements, mounds, alliances, and ambitions. The Mississippian world became more local and equal. Having failed to bring rains and sustain prosperity, the priestly elite lost its authority. But the world also became more violent as people scattered, seeking new resources and attachments in new places. A mega flood may have brought about the final abandonment of Cahokia in the mid-14th century, but the great city had already been in decline for several generations. Cahokia's fading was symptomatic. By the time of its final abandonment, every other major Mississippian city lay vacant. All across the eastern half of the continent, people seemed to have rejected the domineering priestly class for more collective and egalitarian social arrangements. A parallel sequence of instability and adaptation unfolded in the continent's west. A severe drought in the Chaco Canyon region forced the abandonment of Pueblo Bonito around 1130 CE. Facing harvest failures and famine, many ancestral Puebloans deserted their villages and great houses and moved south, gradually forging new identities as Hopis, Zunis, and Pueblos along the Rio Grande Valley. Others migrated north to the Mesa Verde region, where, in a remarkably creative burst, they carved a new civilization out of an unforgiving rocky landscape. Drawing on their long-standing engineering expertise, they constructed multi-room houses and stone palaces, featuring dozens of rooms, several underground kivas, and towers on high alcoves beneath protruding cliffs. They refitted their hydrologic technologies to the dry desert conditions and adopted terrace farming, which relied on check dams to capture natural runoff and retain topsoil for corn, beans, and squash. 20,000 people may have lived in the Mesa Verde region in the 13th century. As in the East, however, the onset of the Little Ice Age triggered a series of changes that ultimately fractured these early agricultural societies. As the land yielded less and less, and as the traditional systems of authority and hierarchy crumbled, people dispersed. The Hohokam people abandoned most of their adobe villages and irrigation works in the Salt River Valley after successive environmental upheavals. A severe generation-long drought in the late 13th century, followed by a protracted period of sparse and erratic rainfall, fueling both internal and external violence. The Hohokams did not disappear. They shifted shape, transforming into a smaller group that would later become the Tohono O'odham people. Farther south, the Mogollon people seem to have reacted to the changing conditions earlier and more decisively. Sometime in the late 12th century, a new city, Pakime, rose south of the Rio Grande in the foothills of the Sierra Madre Occidental Range. Surrounded by several wide rivers, Pakime quickly emerged as a major commercial and political center, commanding a hinterland of some 10,000 people living in hundreds of settlements. Its builders were corn farmers, hydrologic engineers, and traders, and they built a new adobe-walled city, ceremonial mounds, ball courts, and a 2,000-room apartment complex that bore a resemblance to ancestral Puebloan architecture. Pakime arose in the transitional belt, where North America becomes Mesoamerica, embodying one of the greatest turning points in the history of the Americas. North America was diverging from the rest of the Western Hemisphere. Elsewhere, the historical momentum was toward greater concentrations of power, monumental ceremonial centers and cities, and nations of many thousands persisted, reaching apogees in the major Mayan city-state of Chichen Itza in northern Yucatan. The Inca Empire that extended more than 2,000 miles north-south along western South America and in the 15th-century city of Teotihuacan in the Valley of Mexico, home to 150,000 people and ruled by an Aztec emperor and high priests. By then, Cahokia's ruins were already covered by grass. If the Little Ice Age posed daunting challenges to North America's agricultural societies, it was a boon for the continent's hunters. The cool and wet conditions favored buffalo and grama grasses. The bison's preferred forage, and the springs were wet, supporting crucial early growth of grass after the winter's deprivations. Now the sole surviving species of megafauna, the supremely adaptable and prolific bison faced no serious competitors, and the herds expanded their range all the way from the Rocky Mountain foothills to hundreds of miles east of the Mississippi River and from the subarctic to the Gulf of Mexico. And where bison herds thinned out, thriving deer herds took over, their domain covering much of the eastern half of the continent. The majority of North American Indians became generalists who farmed, hunted, and gathered to sustain themselves. Instead of striving to maximize agricultural output, an aspiration that had animated ancestral Puebloans, Cahokians, and other early farming societies, they sought stability, security, and solidarity. Instead of priestly rulers, they preferred leaders whose principal obligation was to maintain consensus and support participatory political systems. Power flowed through the leaders, not from them. Most North Americans lived in villages rather than cities. Ancestral Pawnees, Arikaras, Mandans, and Hidatsas were typical. They settled along the upper Missouri Valley, where capillary action drew groundwater to the surface. They lived in dome-shaped earth lodge villages that housed hundreds rather than thousands. They were horticulturists and built fortifications only rarely. This sweeping retreat from hierarchies, elite dominance, and large-scale urbanization may have turned North America, along with Australia, into the world's most egalitarian continent at the time. The collective mindset that prevailed, reflecting broad-based and carefully balanced economies, also distinguished North America's indigenous peoples. The continental grasslands, the Great Plains, were teeming with tens of millions of buffalo. Huge herds blackened the flat plains to the horizon, pulling humans in. The Shoshones moved east from the Great Basin. The Blackfoot came from the northeast, and the Crows, Omahas, Poncas, and Kansas abandoned their villages and fields along the Missouri Valley. The Kiowas migrated south from the upper Yellowstone Valley and forged an alliance with the resident Apaches. Former farmers did not give up tilling, but all of them now hunted bison, surrounding them in large communal hunts and felling them with spears and arrows, chasing them into concealed corrals in riverbeds or driving them over cliffs to their deaths. In the Black Hills, hunters stampeded bison herds, driving the panicked animals into a corridor marked by stones that channeled the beasts toward a buffalo jump, a steep sinkhole where the high fall did the killing. The Blackfoot called the method of buffalo jumping piskun, or deep blood kettle, and the Blackfoot word for their main jump site translates to head smashed in, after an incident in which buffalo falling from 60 feet above had crushed a young hunter. The site had been used for thousands of years, and tens of thousands of bison had been killed, butchered, and processed for food, tools, and clothing. There may have been hundreds of buffalo jumps across the Great Plains. As the second millennium approached its midpoint, nearly every corner of North America was inhabited or used by humans. People had studied, selected, and perfected seeds, and they had harnessed rivers and streams to carve gardens out of the desert. They had learned how to properly appeal to the spirits, lacing their mastery over the world with humility, and they had imagined new ways to harvest the plant and animal bounty around them. For their labors, they had been amply rewarded. Their communities were prosperous and growing in numbers, and they were spreading beyond their core territories, filling in the vacant spaces between them. The continent was home to approximately 5 million people. In North America, leaders were not autocrats commanding and coercing subjects. They were instead arbitrators and facilitators striving for consensus. They did not seek to maximize personal power. They sought to maximize the number of their followers. Good leaders were poor. They accepted trade goods and gifts from allies, but to govern effectively, they had to redistribute most of the goods among their people. Their reward was loyalty, and expansive networks of fictive kinship that could extend to numerous allied nations. With few exceptions, this became the norm in North America. Kinship, an all-pervasive sense of relatedness and mutual obligations, became the central organizing principle for human life. Kinship was the crucial adhesive that kept people and nations linked together. It would be a mistake to see this adaptation as some kind of a failure or aberration of civilization, as European newcomers almost invariably did. North American Indians had experimented with ranked societies and all-powerful spiritual leaders, and had found them deficient and dangerous. They had opted for more horizontal, participatory, and egalitarian ways of being in the world, a communal ethos available to everyone who was capable of proper thoughts and deeds and willing to share their possessions. Their ideal society was a boundless commonwealth that could be, at least in theory, extended to outsiders infinitely. Chapter 3. Blind Conquests. Across an ocean, mirroring North America's trajectory, peoples and nations had lived through two weather regimes, enjoying startling opportunities during the warm period starting in the 10th century and then struggling to adjust to the diminishing prospects of the Little Ice Age from the 12th century onward. The transitions were particularly acute on the peninsula that formed the western tip of the Eurasian landmass. Europe, a vaguely defined geographical area, had formed the northern part of the sprawling Roman Empire, which dominated nearly all the lands around the Mediterranean Sea by 117 CE. When the overstretched Romans began to weaken during the 3rd century under pressure by Germanic migrations from the east, Byzantium emerged as the dominant power in the Mediterranean. Power and commerce shifted east, and Europe was relegated to a neglected periphery of little importance. As Rome shrank back into the small city-state it had once been, the gaping power vacuum it left behind was filled by hundreds of small fiefdoms. Europe languished as an atomistic world until the 10th century, when the climate began to warm up. Western European farmers adopted a three-field system, in which two fields were cultivated while only one was left fallow. It was one of the most important developments in European history, catapulting the continent toward increasing wealth and significance. Ruthless warlords built private armies of heavily armed horsemen and staked out vast personal fiefdoms. Land was controlled by the few, and local peasants were reduced to serfs, agricultural laborers bound to a lord's estate. In return, they received the protection of lords and their knights against Vikings, Muslims, and local thugs. War was glorified as a holy affair, suffused with notions of duty, honor, and loyalty. As in Cahokia and elsewhere in North America, common people fell under a select cadre of holy men who mobilized them to construct towering structures that glorified the otherworldly and its servants on earth. The parallels between the two continents would not last, however. In the 1330s, the royal houses of France and England clashed over the right to the French throne, the start of a draining on-again, off-again war that seemed to drag on forever. Professional armies replaced feudal armies led by local warlords, and the costs of warfare soared, forcing monarchs and their courts to innovate. The French and English crowns both devised more efficient ways to wage and finance war by levying new taxes, imposing tariffs, and expanding the traditional royal cabinets into nascent state bureaucracies. By the close of the war in 1453, when England relinquished its claims on the continent, both kingdoms were well on their way to becoming fiscal military states, led by powerful rulers, capable of raising vast armies and animated by religious piety. A new nexus of power developed around monarchs and merchants, as well as among courts, cities, and clergy. Rulers granted trade privileges to cities, and cities pledged loyalty to sovereigns, their protectors. Cities were the great economic engines of the incipient nation-states in Western Europe, bustling with business, innovations, unprecedented wealth, and soaring ambitions. By the late 15th century, France and England possessed the means and organizational capacity for overseas expansion. Unexpectedly, however, it was Spain, perhaps the weakest of the Western European kingdoms, that planted the first meaningful colonial outposts in the Western Hemisphere. In the early 8th century, Muslims from North Africa had crossed over to the Iberian Peninsula, clashing with the locals and gradually, over several centuries, shoving them farther and farther to the north. Christendom retreated in the face of people it considered infidels, endangering the entire continent. Iberian Christian kingdoms launched the Reconquista almost immediately after the first Muslim forays, but it progressed slowly. Decisive victories finally came in the 13th century, when Christian forces conquered the great Muslim strongholds of Cordoba and Seville. Granada, the last Muslim enclave in the peninsula, became a tributary state of the Kingdom of Castile. Spearheaded by the Iberian kingdoms, Christendom had prevailed against a colossal Islamic challenge, a triumph that quickly transformed into a forceful outward expansion of Western Europe beyond its terrestrial confines, with the Spanish leading the way. Their centuries-long reconquista had refined their fighting skills, instilling their society with a potent martial spirit and elevating the soldier gentleman into the higher echelons of social hierarchy. The Spanish conquered the Canary Islands off the coast of West Africa in the 15th century, gaining a foothold in the Atlantic, along with an education in overseas colonialism and subjugation of non-European and non-Muslim peoples. The Canaries belonged to the Guanche people from North Africa, who mounted a forceful resistance against Spanish colonization, only to succumb to alien European germs. The few survivors were sold into slavery on the Portuguese island of Madeira and in Spain. The lessons in cruelty and brutality that they learned in the Canaries would serve Spanish adventurers well in the New World that was about to appear to them. In 1474, Paolo dal Pozzo Toscanelli, a Florentine astrologer and cartographer, produced his masterwork, a map that showed the western extremes of Europe and northwestern Africa, a slice of East Asia and Oceanus Occidentalis, the Atlantic Ocean, in between. Like all mapmakers, Toscanelli wanted to show facts and formations, but when facts became scarce, imagination took over. He placed Cipangu, the land of the rising sun, Marco Polo's name for Japan, in the northwest corner of Mesoamerica. West of Cipangu, Toscanelli's map showed Cathay, China, also directly reachable across the ocean from Europe. The Western Hemisphere was absent. In its stead, Toscanelli planted a cluster of phantom islands that were mere legends. Toscanelli's remarkable map captured the imagination of an experienced Genoese mariner, emboldening him to propose to the Portuguese court in 1484 an unprecedented exploration voyage. He would sail west, not south around Africa as others had tried, to reach India, China, Japan, and the fabled gold and spice islands of the East Indies. His scheme was promptly rebuffed as absurd. Columbus then tried his luck with Queen Isabel and King Ferdinand of Castile and Aragon, only to be rejected again. But after Granada, the last Muslim city in Iberia, fell to Spain in January 1492, the Spanish monarchs, alarmed by Portuguese advances along the African coast and toward the Canaries, agreed to fund the outlandish enterprise. Christopher Columbus, a self-taught cosmographer of humble origins, had his commission to sail into the unknown, where, in classic Reconquista style, he could claim immense possessions for himself and his sponsors. Led by Spain, Western Europe was turning away from the perilous Mediterranean and toward the Atlantic and its untapped riches. But it was an almost blind venture, expecting very little from the idiosyncratic mariner. Isabel and Fernando promised that he would be admiral and viceroy and governor of any lands he encountered, and would hold those titles from successor to successor forever and always. Not least, and of more immediate interest, Columbus would also receive a tenth of the net yield of the treasures he took. In the fall of 1492, the Taínos, an indigenous people who dominated much of the Caribbean, spotted three curious vessels approaching the coast. As the newcomers landed, the Taínos, a seagoing people and wide-ranging traders, seemed to welcome them as an addition to their hierarchical network. The Taínos were organized into five stratified societies, led by paramount caciques, kings, and the strangers could be slotted in as junior allies. Columbus and his crew of 88 had arrived in what he thought was the East Indies. Although he was relieved to find land, the voyage had taken longer than expected after a stopover in the Canaries. The people he now encountered were disappointing. They welcomed the exhausted Spanish with gifts and food, hoping to turn the strangers into kin. But they lived in seemingly modest villages that contained none of the treasures, gold, silver, spices, silk, that Columbus and his party sought. Appalled, Columbus enslaved the Taínos. He was convinced that the Indians thought the Spanish had descended from the heavens, probably mistaking their awe of the Spanish vessels and metal tools as reverence. He named the land, an island, he soon discovered, San Salvador, and claimed it for Spain. Unknowingly, Columbus had brought together two parts of humankind that had been separated by oceans for several millennia. The indigenous inhabitants may have appeared utterly alien and inferior to the Spanish, but the two sapiens' contingents were genetically identical. All of their meaningful differences were cultural. Columbus may have been disillusioned, but he knew what he, a good European, should do. He came from a society where one's position was determined largely by birth. One found purpose in preaching, fighting, or serving others. For Columbus and his contemporaries, there was little doubt where the Taínos belonged in that order. To Spanish eyes, they were primitive heathens living on an isolated island, and thus familiar. Spanish soldier mariners had subdued similar people in the Canary Islands only a few decades earlier. The conquest of the Canaries had served as a laboratory of overseas imperialism, educating the Spanish in how to make strangers subjects, even slaves. Obsessed with gold, Columbus spent weeks in the West Indies hunting for it, and along the way he began to distinguish between good Indians and bad Indians. Good Indians were meek and made docile servants. Bad Indians resisted Spanish demands and fought back. Good Indians could be converted. Bad Indians should be enslaved. Columbus had given Spain a blueprint for a new world empire. After sailing back to Spain to secure royal support, he returned to America a year later with 15 caravels, two smaller vessels, and 1,500 men. He had identified a new resource, and the Spanish promptly enslaved 1,600 Indians. Columbus and the Spanish conquistadors who followed in his wake found the American tropics strangely welcoming. The American tropics were healthy and hospitable, one of the upshots of the Little Ice Age, and the conquistadors tore through Española, Puerto Rico, Jamaica, and Cuba within a decade, seeking the ever-elusive Spice Islands, but eventually settling on hoarding gold and slaves. Extraordinary beasts and technologies, horses, guns, and steel, coupled with a deep-rooted tradition of violent conquest, brought galvanizing military victories for the newcomers. Yet it was the diseases the Europeans carried in their bodies, smallpox, measles, influenza, and others, that made possible the wholesale subjugation of the Greater Antilles, ripping through unexposed indigenous populations with lethal efficiency. Military imperialism, coupled with biological imperialism, caused the first Native American population catastrophe. Hundreds of thousands of people perished, and most of the survivors were enslaved as heathens without rights. Clamoring for quick profits, the Spanish were thorough. On Española's Pearl Coast, they forced enslaved native divers to make life-threatening descents to gather pearls. Soon the Spanish found themselves presiding over islands that were nearly devoid of people. They continued to search for new opportunities, gradually realizing that they faced an unknown landmass that surrounded them on three sides. This was not what Toscanelli's map showed. An unwavering belief in Spanish superiority over the Indians, combined with a moral crusade to spread Christianity among the heathens, emboldened the Spanish newcomers. Already in 1493, Pope Alexander VI had granted America to Isabel and Ferdinand to rule over and convert Indians. A settlement in the Eastern Caribbean that the Spanish called Isabella served as a staging area for inland entradas, and these expeditions soon revealed a new ocean, the Pacific, extending into the eastern horizon. It was becoming clear that there was no direct passage to Asia from the Atlantic. Whatever treasures there were to be won would have to be found in this odd new world. Spain changed course. In 1502, Nicolas de Ovando's fleet of 30 vessels and 2,500 settlers launched the colonization of the Americas by landing on an island they called Santo Domingo. As if by fate, exploration and native informants soon revealed the existence of prosperous indigenous empires not too far into the interior of the continent. The gold-hungry conquistadors now had their new targets, which turned out to be astoundingly vulnerable. Small groups of Spanish soldiers would be able to carve out a prodigious empire in less than 20 years. Starting in 1519, Spanish conquistadors invaded the fabulously wealthy Mesoamerican indigenous empires with small but heavily armed forces. Hernán Cortés conquered Tenochtitlan, the seat of the Aztec Empire, with 1,300 men, having destroyed his ships after making landfall to ensure that his men would not abandon him. Cortés founded the encomienda system, a modified version of European feudalism, which awarded subdued native communities to individual conquistadors to govern and profit from. His brash incursion, mightily assisted by smallpox and indigenous allies, had created New Spain, a distinctly Hispanic realm superimposed on a pre-existing imperial indigenous bedrock. 10 years later, inspired by Cortés's feat, Francisco Pizarro marched with a small posse of soldiers into the heart of the Inca Empire, trekking along the steep Inca highways and shocking the empire's foot soldiers with his cavalry. Pizarro captured Atahualpa, the Sapa Inca, ruler of the Inca Empire. By 1550, what the Spanish called Peru had yielded them more than 80 tons of gold and silver and billions of calories drawn from the large terraced fields of potatoes, quinoa, and corn. Like Cortés, Pizarro had succeeded by placing himself atop a pre-existing network of workers, vassals, and wealth. In the 1550s, roughly half a century after Columbus's landing, Spain seemed primed for hemispheric dominance. A distinctive form of Spanish colonization had emerged, drawn from the experience of the Reconquista and the appropriation of the Canary Islands. Spanish colonization received an enormous boost from what has become known as the Columbian Exchange, the widespread transfer of people, animals, plants, ideas, technology, and diseases among the Americas, Europe, and West Africa. Far more Indians died of European diseases than of European bullets and steel. The Spanish crown held its American colonies in an iron grip, imposing its hierarchical system of government on the colonies and carefully controlling the planning, pace, and practice of colonization. Spain's American empire was to be an empire of towns that each helped oversee political, social, and religious life under the supervision of an adelantado, a nobleman serving his sovereign. New Spain would be a stratified, multiracial empire of a single language, Castilian, a single faith, Roman Catholicism, and a single ruler, the Spanish monarch, governed from the mother country through a robust bureaucracy of local administrators, a highly effective transportation system of annual and heavily armed fleets transported stolen wealth, silver, gold, pearls, sugar, salt, hides, and slaves into Spain, fueling further colonial ambitions. Enjoying nearly complete control of the Caribbean shoreline, Spain began shifting from violent colonial expansion, always an unpredictable enterprise, to bureaucratic colonial governing. Suddenly, at this early stage, there was room for dissenting voices, such as that of the Dominican friar Bartolomé de las Casas, who condemned the Spanish atrocities against Native Americans in the early 16th century and advocated a softer form of colonialism, prompting King Charles V of Spain to enact the 1542 New Laws of the Indies for the Good Treatment of the Indians, which regulated the encomienda system and outlawed Indian slavery. As the 16th century inched toward its midpoint, Spain had become the world's most powerful nation, the annual silver fleets from America sustaining its might in Europe and beyond. But then its expansionist momentum began to fade. Forging a new world empire had been made remarkably easy by war horses, steel, gunpowder, and diseases. Great indigenous empires fell like dominoes in the face of small conquistador armies, yielding massive quantities of silver and gold. Spain had won a prodigious New World Empire with minimal investments and losses, and a sense of complacency set in. There were smaller, poorer, and harder to access Mesoamerican realms to subjugate and plunder, but the Spanish had grown used to quick and huge profits. The more modest and isolated realms did not seem worth the trouble. Increasingly ambitious Spanish began gazing north for new opportunities. They thought they had plenty of time. While the Spanish toppled mighty indigenous empires, the French and English, preoccupied with each other, were just gearing up to explore the rest of America to the north. They would be disappointed. Part 2. Appear at a distance like giants. The long 16th century. Chapter 4. Terra Nullius. They spotted the three vessels approaching from the blue, steadily gliding toward the shoreline. The Calusa Indians had learned about such things, and they knew what to expect. The men on those bulky ships were strangers from the south, where they had killed untold numbers of people and declared themselves masters of the few who survived. Usually their ships skirted Calusa land on their way out to the deep sea, but now they were coming straight toward them. These were men who wanted everything the Calusas had: their land, their treasure, their labor, their souls. The Calusas knew exactly what to do with them. Despite the lethal epidemics, enslavement, and mass killings, the Caribbean basin was still an indigenous space thickly webbed by trade and diplomatic networks that disseminated information fast and wide. The Calusas allowed the boats to slip near the coastline before releasing a cascade of arrows. The attack shocked the Spanish. This was not how the Indians were supposed to act in the face of guns, iron weapons, and carracks. The leader of the small fleet was Juan Ponce de Leon, a veteran of Columbus's second voyage to America in 1493. He had done very well for himself in the New World, having crushed an uprising of Taino people in the Greater Antilles and claimed Puerto Rico for the Spanish crown, which rewarded him in 1508 with the governorship of the island. Puerto Rico's sugar, gold, and Indian slaves had made Ponce de Leon stupendously rich. Although the Calusas knew what to expect, Ponce de Leon knew very little about the land and people he meant to seize through the doctrine of terra nullius, empty land, or no man's land. In reality, Florida was home to some 350,000 Indians. European nations refused to acknowledge indigenous sovereignty because they saw the Native Americans as savages and believed that the Indians did not use the land properly. They did not improve it with intensive farming, leaving it devoid of civilization. Ponce de Leon did not know that the 20,000-strong Calusas commanded a vast territory and numerous tributary villages that spread out for hundreds of miles, as well as massive water courts made from shells and sediment to catch fish and other aquatic wealth. Their seat of power was an immense structure that accommodated 2,000 people. After the conquest of Mesoamerica, the Spanish considered Florida the land of flowers, a low-hanging fruit. Taken aback by the determined indigenous resistance he met, Ponce de Leon beat a hasty retreat to Puerto Rico in 1514. The Spanish labeled their vanquishers gente de color quebrado, people of broken color. Nothing if not stubborn, Ponce de Leon tried again in 1521, leading his second entrada, consisting of 200 colonists, to the same spot on Florida's Gulf Coast. He ordered his men to build houses. They did not finish a single one. The Calusas mobilized immediately and a fierce battle erupted. Ponce de Leon was struck by an arrow. He ordered a retreat to Cuba, where he soon died from the wound. And that same year, Alonso Alvarez de Pineda traced the Gulf Coast westward and then southward, discovering the mouth of the Mississippi River and determining that Florida was not an island, but a peninsula attached to a landmass of unknown size. Viewed from the Spanish domains in the Caribbean Basin and Mexico, the northern lands appeared promising targets for new colonial ventures. In 1497, Giovanni Caboto, a Venetian mariner in the service of the English crown, landed at a spot on this unknown landform to the north, revealing to Europeans that it was, in fact, a new continent. The Caribbean islands had lost their luster to the conquistadors, who called the Bahamas Las Islas Inútiles, useless islands, because there was no gold or pearls. Spanish ambitions turned north, where untapped reservoirs of minerals, slaves, and converts appeared to await them. Geography itself seemed to invite them in. The breadth of Mesoamerica seemed to offer unrestricted access into the heart of the continent, while the Florida Peninsula bulged deep into the Caribbean Sea like an enormous land bridge. By the second decade of the 16th century, Spanish slavers were pushing to the north, reaping staggering profits. Native slaves had become scarce on the Caribbean sugar islands, where more than 20 years of enslaving and disease epidemics had brought about a demographic collapse, whereas the Indians to the north were taller, stronger, and seemingly inexhaustible as commodities. Some slavers thought of them as giants. Geography channeled Spanish colonization northward also in another way. By the early 1520s, exploration had revealed that there was no water passage to Asia from the Caribbean. Impatient conquistadors redirected their ambitions to the northern continent, which appeared to be free of the obstacles they had faced in the tropics: extreme heat, odd maladies, steep mountain ranges, and impenetrable jungles. They began to push in. A generation of exploration and colonization had taught the Spanish that although the coasts might yield few riches, the interior was likely to offer plenty. Florida also seemed to be thinly populated. The Spanish did not know that infectious diseases had cut Florida's indigenous population by hundreds of thousands within two generations. In 1528, 7 years after Ponce de Leon's death by a Calusa arrow, Pánfilo de Narváez, who had conquered Cuba in 1511, appeared on the scene. He had lobbied energetically in Seville and succeeded magnificently. The Council of the Indies had authorized him to colonize Florida, the northern Gulf Coast, and the lands to the west all the way to the Pacific. If Narvaez were successful, his holdings would eclipse Cortez's enormous fiefdom in Mexico. Boasting 5 ships, 80 horses, some 400 sailor soldiers, 10 women, several African slaves, and 5 Franciscan brothers, Narvaez's new venture was Spain's most ambitious attempt to occupy, civilize, and purify North America so far. It also turned out to be one of the most incompetent. Narvaez's destination was the Rio de las Palmas on the western Gulf Coast. But the Gulf Stream, the world's strongest ocean current, sent the ships hundreds of miles off target. The Spanish landed on Florida's west coast, where they sighted a native town of the Timucuas. The Indians fled, and Narvaez claimed their land for Spain. A reconnaissance party captured 4 Indians who told the Spanish of a distant province controlled by the Apalache people, where there was much gold. North American Indians had learned what fueled Spanish ambitions. Narvaez split his force in 2, one contingent following the coast on foot with horses, the other sailing near it, and both heading toward the Rio de las Palmas in Tamaulipas, where they would unite. They never did. The Sea Party soon lost contact with the Overland Party and realized that the Rio de las Palmas was hundreds of miles away. They waited a year for the Overland Party to emerge before giving up and heading to Cuba. In the meantime, the landbound contingent had shifted from a colonial venture to a much older indigenous script. They were only 90 miles away from Cuba, but lacking ships, they might as well have been on the other side of the world. Led by Narvaez and his second-in-command, Alvar Núñez Cabeza de Vaca, a nobleman and the royal treasurer of the expedition, some 300 Spanish and a few Africans marched northwest toward Apalache country, navigating hot swamps, torrential rivers, and cynical Indians who urged them to move ahead by telling them the riches were that way. Their conquistador fantasies crumbling, the Spanish reached the Apalaches in June and attacked the first village they saw, taking its women and children as hostages. The town leader offered to take the place of the hostages, becoming a hostage himself. Apalache country, however, was no Aztec or Inca empire on top of which the conquistadors could plant themselves as rulers. Instead of hoarding riches, they were reduced to scouring for food while fending off Indians, who, according to Cabeza de Vaca, made continual war upon us, wounding our people and horses at the places where they went to drink water. The captured native leader portrayed Apalache country as a poor and sparsely populated realm, while in reality, it was a thriving nation of tens of thousands. He urged the newcomers to head to the coast, where, he said, they would find plenty of corn, beans, and fish in a town called Ayut. Narvaez swallowed the bait. Apalache soldiers prepared an ambush in a deep lagoon, where, upon arrival of the Spanish, they released a shower of arrows. Cabeza de Vaca was shocked by the power and accuracy of the native bowmen, who appear at a distance like giants and could send an arrow through an elm tree. Here, in trackless swamps and inlets, the Indians neutralized Spain's technological advantages through superior mobility and creative use of the terrain. The conquistadors made it to the shore, but they had become dangerously weakened. Depleted, they were exposed to viruses, and soon a third of them were sick. They fled on makeshift rafts, desperate to escape the arrows of the local Indians. When they landed on the west coast of Florida, Camone Indians promptly killed them. A gust pushed Narvaez's raft into the open sea, leaving him stranded. He died from dehydration, with a panoramic view of his vast paper holdings, which he would never rule. The surviving conquistadors posed no threat to native peoples. Now gunless, horseless, and weak, they simply became useful. Cabeza de Vaca became the embodiment of this reduced status. He still had 40 men, and they were kindly received by the Kapok and Han Indians, who fed and healed them. This was the flip side of indigenous territoriality. Outsiders who acted weak and asked to be pitied were likely to be embraced as allies and kin. The surviving castaways became workers. It was a humiliating role reversal. The would-be conquistadors reduced to hauling firewood, carrying water, and digging roots. Cabeza de Vaca reinvented himself as a trader, a role that won him one of the most precious rights an unfree person could have in the Americas: mobility. For the next several years, with three compatriots, including a freed African slave named Estebanico, he operated as a merchant among various indigenous nations. Cabeza de Vaca assumed the role of a holy man and a healer in an attempt to capitalize on European medical knowledge. For 2 years, the foursome he had assembled traveled along indigenous roads, visiting native villages, receiving food, shelter, and escorts from the Indians. They may well have been more entertaining and less extraordinary to their hosts than they liked to believe, however. The four men eventually resolved to move south toward Mexico City, where they arrived in the summer of 1536. The story of Cabeza de Vaca and his fellow castaways is the story of North America's early colonization in microcosm. The four survivors' improbable journey out of Florida became both a lure and a lesson for prospective colonists. It illuminated a previously obscure continent full of riches and potential subjects, but it also introduced North America as an indigenous continent, thoroughly suffused with human presence, even after many disease outbreaks, and made it clear that newcomers who failed to obey indigenous rules would have no place in it. Cabeza de Vaca had accepted this reality and was rewarded with kinship and belonging. His pliant immersion offered in all.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.